Hello, good morning and welcome to another edition of Bits and Banter. Today we are here, Bala and I are here early morning to talk about goats. Not the one which goes meh. We are talking about greatest of all times.
So it's the opposite of meh.
Yeah.
It's so oral.
So let me just give you a number. Roger Federer won his first Wimbledon in 2003. Since then, 68 titles, Grand Slam titles, of which 60 these dudes have won here. I'm talking about Roger Federer, Rafael Nadal, and Novak Djokovic. So nobody else had a chance. It's almost like, okay, you play all other matches, we will win this. So you better go home. I mean, no point playing. So Bala, first of all, welcome. Good morning.
And good morning. Good morning to you from Chennai, and you're in Delhi, right?
I'm in Delhi. So So my question is, what the hell is happening to the world of tennis? Number one. Number two, Novak Djokovic, is he the greatest of all goats now? Or the three goats?
Yeah, it's an obvious question that crops up after his great victory last night in Wimbledon, where he defeated Matteo Berrettini in four sets after losing the first set. My basic theory is, I don't go by the numbers, but my basic theory is Novak Djokovic, and under pressure Novak Djokovic is always better than the front running Novak Djokovic.
Yeah.
See, you asked me the question. See, apart from these two, three dudes, we have had Grand Slam winners, Andy Murray, who has won three titles, Stan Wawrinka, Del Potro, Mirren, I mean, Cilic has won. And who else has won? I mean, these are the guys who readily come to mind. Apart from Murray and Wawrinka, nobody has won more than one title. So these are the dominance. We need not say that the numbers, as you rightly pointed out, they are staggering. They clearly point out an unprecedented, historically unprecedented dominance. So, and we are privileged to watch three guys top of their game, top of their mental abilities, top of their skill sets, and top of everything from 2004. These guys have had the kind of run that is impossible in any other sport. Now, getting back to the other question that you posed, Djokovic, about the greatest of the three. See, it's a tough one. If you are going by just to a big crowd favorite, of course, let's not forget the fact that sports in general is also about spectatorship and as a spectacle. So when it comes to making it as a spectacle, it is Roger Federer. He is a crowd favorite because of all the three, he is the most pleasant to watch. And if you go by just sheer dominance of one particular surface, it's Rafael Nadal. His 13 victories in Roland Garros is almost unsurpassable. But if you're going to talk about all surface dominance, you have to go and give it to Djokovic. So it's a very tough question. But I'll stick my neck out and say, Raj, it should be Djokovic. I'm a big fan of Roger Federer. But then again, we'll go back to just sheer numbers. He is the one among the three. He is the only one who has won the Grand Slam, all the four Grand Slam, at least twice. All titles at least twice. See, Rafael Nadal has only one Australian Open title. Roger Federer has only one French Open title. Whereas this guy has on all the three, at least minimum of two trophies. His lowest two being at French Open.
Yeah.
So that gives us the number. And very particularly against head-to-head, against Rafael Nadal as well as against Roger Federer, the numbers are in favor of Djokovic. I don't have the simple numbers, but they are in favor of Djokovic. So I must stick my neck out and say Djokovic is, as you rightly said, is the goat among the goats.
Yeah,
you have a word for
that.
It.
So I'll add to that. Mala, think of the scenario today. We have one more Grand Slam to go in this year, right?
Exactly.
Can he get a calendar Grand Slam?
Yes.
That definitely makes him second to the all-time legend of tennis, Rod Laver.
Exactly.
There's been nobody else. So
to win the first three Grand Slams in the year, it has happened only once before. I mean, the last time it happened was in 1969.
Yeah. So you are on the cusp of something terrific. Even if he doesn't win, I think he's still the greatest of all goats. Plus, I think he's good enough, health permitting. I mean, I think he's the most healthy of the three. He's the youngest of the three. So if he plays till Roger Federer's age, by some Roger Federer is 40 years right now, right? If he plays for another 6 years, this fellow is going to have another 10, 15 titles in his bag, man. I mean, so
that's staggering.
By sheer numbers, like you said, I completely agree with you. Sheer numbers, this guy is going to be ahead of everybody. And and to me, I think apart from his story that we all know, the story, the tragedy coming from a war-torn country, blah blah blah, all of that. What I like about this fellow is he enjoys the damn game. Yeah, exactly. He's never looking morose. He's never looking upset. He's always in that that fun zone, and he seems to connect with his opponents better than anybody else.
He's an emotional guy on the court.
Yeah, yeah.
He goes extreme. I mean, he can be extremely pleasant, and some people allege he's also not averse to gamesmanship. So he's a guy who spills his guts on the court. But the greatest thing is he didn't have a great start to his Grand Slam career. I mean, just Grand Slam in his first, say, 13 Grand Slam finals that he made to, he won only 6 of them. He lost 7 of them. So mentally, he understood there is a mental side to the game. And as he rightly said after last night's match, he kind of wanted to emulate Nadal and Federer. So those guys were the impetus for him. So much so, in his next 14 Grand Slam finals appearances, he lost only 3. So that is where the mental side of the things. And he unabashedly said he the guys who made him go that extra mile was these two guys.
These two chaps, yeah.
So that's great,
yeah.
No?
Yeah, so that is sportsmanship. See, when we talk about brinkmanship and sportsmanship, there is a difference.
Exactly.
Right? I mean, see, brinkmanship is where you actually try to take your enemy out before the guy enters the court. This guy, with these two chaps, at least he has never done that. I can't remember him doing that. He has done it. I mean, we all guys who on the sports field, they do have some idiosyncrasies. They do have some brinkmanship. They do all of that. But this guy doesn't seem to. So you hit the nail on the head. So he recognizes the goats and says, okay, these two are goats. I want to be a goat.
Exactly.
Well, just see, because you're rare.
And the post-match press conference, he was also clear. He was unhesitant to say, I am the best.
Yeah.
Because he's clear, right now he's the best. But he didn't get into the greatest of all. That is for the time to decide.
Yes.
Because you are talking about people across eras, across your opponents. So he didn't get into that debate. But as of now, he is very clear. Me, as the top player, he is very clear. I mean, he is aware of his abilities.
When you are number one, you have stayed number one for 320 some weeks, or I don't know. I mean, some crazy
then again, that is a record.
He, yeah,
because
yeah,
that is one record that he went after. He took it from Federer, of course. From all these numbers, it is between these guys. Yeah.
These three guys only. And then I think there are only one or two numbers that people from another era share with him. I think Pete Sampras shares some record with him right now. And then I think there is one record he shares with one of his goat friends, Rafael Nadal. That is all I remember vaguely.
Yeah, so, but this is, I mean, as I rightly said, this is, I mean, I can't say as I rightly said, that's a wrong one. I mean, we are just privileged.
Completely privileged. Yeah, I mean, I would consider, I think, Bala, I saw your tweet also that watching Wimbledon finals with the family is a 36-year history for you.
Yes,
so I saw that. Person. So I agree. This one I missed because I was obviously traveling. By the time I came, Nadal had won. So I can't ask him to replay, man. Djokovic had won. And I couldn't say, just start again, man. What is this here? You can't just do this to me. But then, yeah. So that was a miss. But I agree. See, I started watching tennis from the Bjorn Borg era.
Yeah. I was following it, but caught it on TV only from 1985. Kevin Kieran versus Boris Becker.
Yeah. So that was
a kind of a watershed era because Boris Becker, big
for me, it was the previous one. I'll tell you because it was, I watched the era where Bjorn Borg was the king of tennis.
Wimbledon.
Tennis. I mean, he was winning tennis. Other places also. And then you had an upstart called John McEnroe coming in, losing the finals and next year winning the finals. So for me, that was a watershed also. So I saw the changeover from one generation.
81, 82, that's right.
And after
the 84 finals, I do remember when McEnroe completely unhinged Jimmy Connors.
Yes. So now, what I feel is that in the last 18 years, I have not seen anything like that. That is the problem. These guys have come and said, oh yeah, this belongs to us. You guys go play in some chota field. I don't care.
Yeah, because there was a time when we were watching Becker, Edberg, Lendl, Sampras, and then Jim Courier, Mats Wilander, you had this Swedish army, everything. Raptor, so many other players, all absolutely good players. And at that time, we all were under the impression that we were witnessing something great. But when out of the blue, these three guys came and they changed the entire sport. So probably we may have people emerging. We never know.
Yeah, I'm sure they will. But I'm sure that we will see a handing over. I mean, passing the baton, as they call it. Now the point is that there is one guy who is 35. There is one guy who is 34.
Another guy will be 40 next month.
Yeah. the guy in 40 is playing for love. The 35-year-old guy is playing on steam. On fumes or whatever you call it, because our man has injuries. Exactly. And this third guy seems to be in a trip of his own.
His mind is well set on the US Open and about the US Olympics. Tokyo Olympics, he's not really sure. He says he's 50-50. Because if he makes it to the Olympics and manages to win the gold, that will be a golden slam only step. That we talk about three guys. Also not forget that when you talk of tennis, there is also the women's side, and there are women who are well past the 20 mark that we men. You have Serena Williams on the current player who has won 23 Grand Slam titles. So we are being slightly unfair also, because we don't bring them into the equation at all. You had Steffi Graf, who had won including Olympics, four Grand Slams and Olympics in a single year.
Correct.
Those things have precedence.
Yeah.
In a sense.
I just want to ask you, Bala. I mean, is there any truth in the rumors that it was actually Ravi Shastri's coaching that helped Djokovic win? Because he was there.
He was there. He put his mug out. One of his tweets. So it was interesting because.
He didn't coach him, no?
Yeah.
Go for it, boys. Like something.
Ivanisevic was there, because Ivanisevic has bulked up from the wiry, lean bean pole that we saw him in the early 2000s.
Ivanisevic looks like Ivan Vasevic. No. Present tense, he looks different. Bad joke.
It was a historic day for sportsmen, because when last Wimbledon finals happened, that was in 2019, it was a historic day because it's an amazing finals between Djokovic and Roger Federer. Perhaps the second greatest final after Nadal and Federer final. So on the day, England managed to win the Cricket World Cup. That happened in 2019. Yesterday, unfortunately for England, they couldn't win the Euro 2020. They lost out to Italy in the penalties. But another legend, another GOAT from football, Lionel Messi, managed to put behind his demons in the finals for Argentina. Behind, managed to win it for Argentina 1-0 against Brazil in Copa America. So that was a great day, historically speaking, great day. And India in the women's cricket managed to win against England in T20. It's an amazing win. It's a comeback. Yeah. We managed to pick out six wickets for around 30 runs in the last five overs. That was an amazing win. And the great thing about the Indian women's team win was, then again, the fielding stood out. It was amazing. Yeah.
I can tell you. I actually saw one of India's top ministers tweeting fielding this thing by Harleen Dion at the boundary. She actually tweeted that. She's a minister. I'm talking about Smriti Irani. She tweeted about that, and she's a minister of women empowerment. I'm sure she saw that differently, and she tweeted that. I was amazed. I don't think she's a cricket fan. Never seen her tweet that before. But this one was unique. So I think we should take cognizance of that and say, and I think these guys have won after many years. There is also a record there.
Yeah, because we are winning in England against England in a T20. The last time it happened was in 2006, when Indian team had never even played T20.
Yeah. So a lot of history, but I think it was the greatest of all days for sport, I guess.
But I like the way that New Zealand cricket has gone. I saw two tweets from Jimmy Neesham and Scott Stiles. See, in the finals, it was 1-1. And after the penalties, during the penalties, when the deadlock was not resolved, don't they go by more number of passes or more number of corners? These guys are still salty, man.
the point is, you can't blame them.
You can't blame them.
That is, I think, one of the dumbest rules I've ever come across.
It was there in the books.
So, yeah, I mean, that's the point. I mean, it was there in the books. It was, but then, see, it was there. Like, we discussed this on
Banter
that time. I think it was there in the books because I don't think anybody noticed. They didn't realize that it will come to this. So, what if the force were equal? I'm just thinking.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. How many people are wearing black underwear? Save it. who knows, man?
Yeah, I don't know, because I mean,
you can't blame them for being still morose about angry about it. Although they have won the World Test Championship, I think Bala, this was great.
Yeah, exactly.
So we'll end up saying that this guy is definitely on the verge of Djokovic is definitely on the verge of being the greatest of all goats.
Certainly, it was our pleasure watching all the sports, and we'll end the show with the hope that we'll stop it and watch the NBA Finals, which is currently on.
Milwaukee. We'll be happy to talk about the Olympics, which is scheduled. So we'll look forward to that. Obviously, we look forward to the India and England series. We look forward to a lot. I mean, sports, I think, is coming as a fresh breath of life and vigor or whatever it is after this COVID. So, Delhi has eased the lockdown. I've seen people walking around without a mask. I'll still tell them, look, the worst is not over. We can have a third wave. We are not yet out of the woods. So, I think mask up and stay home if you can.
Yeah, but just wind up. Sports has given us hope. So, let's not lose sports, because unfortunately, what has happened in England, the reports coming from Englanders after the loss against Italy, there are a lot of few incidents of racism against Italians and against the blacks, because the penalty misses were of black color. So some of the tweets on Twitter and some of the things that we see on social media is not very palatable. So let's not see. So sports is the way out of this mess that the world finds itself in. So let's not lose sports to other things, other extraneous bad things.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. Sports is a great leveler. It's a unifier. It cannot be a divisive element.
Exactly.
And the idiots who are doing this, I think, I just said it, they are idiots. So, I mean, I'm calling them out. They are idiots with a capital I followed by all other letters in capitals. So, there you go. Thanks, Vala. Thanks for the show. And then we'll see you soon. We'll catch up soon. So, take care. Stay safe. Continue to stay safe. And have a great week ahead. Bye.
Bye.